A Tuesday night doubleheader is in the books. That was on TNT. Here we are on Game Time on NBA TV. Ernie Johnson, Isaiah Thomas, and Kevin McHale. We'll start with game two of that doubleheader, which was the debut of LeBron James in a Laker uniform in Staples Center as they played host to the Denver Nuggets. And we take you to Los Angeles. And LeBron had made his debut in San Diego, but fans in L.A. getting their first look up close and personal at what they can expect to see from 23.
Yeah, and there's a buzz in the building. When he steps in, he starts taking it down like that, going full court, length of the court, and throwing it down. Anywhere LeBron goes, there's always just energy, and he brings it, boy.
Drops it off to Brandon Ingram, who hits JaVale McGee for the easy two.
And when you talk about energy, the Lakers are definitely looking to get out in transition. And LeBron James walking up into a step-up three, you know, was a good start for them on the offensive side of the basketball.
L.A. talks, or LeBron talks about L.A. getting its offense from good defense. You saw it right there and wound up with the James bucket. And this, check it out.
That's the
Willie B. Buckets. That's Will Barton.
Hey, that's the play you run as a coach all the time. That's your end of the clock play, full court, and it worked.
Yeah, but you'd prefer that it not only just work in preseason, maybe in the regular season it worked. But it was like a charm in that one. Jokic to Monty Morris.
And when you see the ball handling skills of Jokic, you know that the last two plays he's out. Up top, he's making plays, he's passing the ball, he's knocking down a three. We know he has an excellent post-up game. I mean, Jokic is the real deal.
How about Mason Plumlee going 11 for 11?
Well, he should have been. Every one of them has elbows in the rim. I mean, if he missed any of the shots he took tonight, I'd be mad at him.
So LeBron was just chilling as this game came right down to it. A chance for the Lakers to tie or take the lead.
Oh, he's going to shoot that? No.
And they don't get a shot off.
No. Young players came out there and let that one fly.
Yeah, you got to know time and score. And at that point in time, we see that they didn't know the clock. Just one pass too many.
You see LeBron James, 13 points on 5 of 6 shooting. JaVale McGee leads him with 15. Safe to say if that trend continues of JaVale leading him in scoring, it is not going to be the kind of banner year they expect in L.A. But on this night, he has 15. Hart has 14. And it's a 113-111 Denver win as the Lakers cannot get the shot off in the last possession. But that's what happens in the preseason, isn't it, Kevin McHale? This is a teaching time and a learning time.
Yes, it is. At the end of most games, you have guys out there that none of us know. Where'd they play? Where'd they come from? And they're thrown in these situations, and they make some interesting plays at late games, like not shooting that. But, you know, all these young guys have got to learn. It's just the NBA is such a different game with the clock and everything. But, you know, I've seen that many times, young guys at the end of tight games not making the proper play.
What do you think job one is for LeBron James in this setting now?
I say to blend the personalities. I mean, you got a lot of different personalities that come from different basketball cultures, different basketball understanding. And what he's got to try to find a way to do is get a good cohesive understanding of everybody on his team. He and Rondo have played in championship moments. They've won championship rings. So their leadership is going to be paramount on their team to make it all come together.
I think one of the things, too, when you look at some of the core talent that the Lakers brought back before you add James to that mix, and you see what a guy like Kyle Kuzma did in the offseason. And I think you guys know better as players, but what you do in the offseason can be so critical to your development as a player. And Kyle Kuzma hit the weight room. Gained a little weight, gained a little strength, worked on playing center for the first time since high school, worked on guard-type ball-handling skills, just trying to make himself one of these positionless players that you see around the league.
And the other thing that he did was he had long sit-down film sessions with Rondo. And Rondo was talking to him about becoming a better defender. You know, most young players, they always judge their game by how well they play on the offensive side of the basketball. Kuzma has taken on the challenge of now becoming a better defender, better film watcher, better understanding of understanding tendencies of the opponent that he's playing against. So I think that's going to be a big leap for him on the defensive side.
Yeah, and I always found that when you decide what you need to work on, you work on it. Because, like, you come in the league and everybody's telling you what to do. After a year in the league, you know what you need to work on. And you always work harder on that. Because people tell you you need to work on this and that, and I'm thinking, I don't think I need to work on that. You know? And so he found out what he needed to work on, and he put his own program together.
Yeah. Denver a winner, 113-111 over the Lakers. And if you'd like to see the Lakers, you can do that again on Thursday as they take on the Sacramento Kings. That follows the Pacers and the Rockets, which hits the air at 8 o'clock here on NBA TV. When we come back, well, with LeBron in L.A., it wasn't exactly an Eastern Conference Finals rematch in Boston, but highlights of the Cavs and Celtics when we come back as game time rolls. Game time, Kyrie Irving played the first two preseason games, did not go tonight in the rematch of the Eastern Conference Finals, which actually wasn't really a rematch of the Eastern Conference Finals, but Cleveland was playing Boston, and Kevin Love was feeling it early.
Yeah, he was. And, you know, Mikhail, you talked about his post game, you know, and he got Jaylen Brown up and under a couple of times. Looked like a little bit of you.
I worked with him on that move. Now, Kevin's going to have a big year for Cleveland to have any success at all. And you're seeing the Celtics here.
Gordon Hayward
is moving a little bit. But, you know, the Celtics didn't look very good tonight. They didn't look cohesive on the offensive end. And, well, you can see there's a lot of work they have to do, in, you know, from now to the start of the season.
In fact, Brad Stevens had said at halftime wasn't really happy with the energy level that the Celtics were showing on their home floor against Cleveland. And Cavs were able to wear them down. And you saw Colin Sexton, David Nwaba, all contributing down the stretch.
You know, and I really like David Nwaba. I mean, his energy and his effort, you know, is really contagious, and I'm sure it's been contagious throughout camp also.
102-95 is your final score. Love with 17, Sexton with 15. Marcus Smart had 15 to lead the Celtics. Any doubt in your mind the Celtics are the favorite to get to the finals out of the Eastern Conference? How much of a threat is a team like Toronto? How much of a threat is Philadelphia?
I think they're all threats, but I think the Celtics are the favorite because they have the most talent. And they have the most talent, they have a great coach, and they're the favorite.
Yeah, I agree. I think Toronto can give them a run for their money, though. I have a big feeling this year that Kawhi Leonard's going to come out and play really, really well after such a disappointing year last year. So Toronto will give them a run for their money, but the Celtics are just too deep.
Yeah.
That's almost your answer, almost like we had planned it that way. Bring up Toronto and Kawhi Leonard, and we have the highlights of the Raptors and the Utah Jazz from Vivint Smart Home Arena, and Kawhi looking like Kawhi.
I mean, the way he can fit into Toronto, as you know, his ball handling clearly has improved. You know, we know he's a great defender, but I like what he's going to bring to Toronto from a confidence standpoint. And what I mean by that, they'll walk out on the floor every single night thinking that not only can they win, but defensively they can lock people down.
Yeah, and he's got a spot on the floor that, you know, where he's really good, that right box. And this young fella just keeps getting better and better. Spider Mitchell, his playmaking is improving, and you know he can score the ball.
And he says, you know, what he's got to do from last year is not run around like a chicken with his head cut off. Needs to pace himself a little more, but he knows there's no sneaking up on the league this year.
No, there's no sneaking up on the league, and you said the right thing, what he echoed. I can't run around like a chicken with my head cut off. So that just tells me that he's maturing, he's understanding the game, and the game has slowed down from him from an education standpoint.
Selfie time on the sidelines for Mitchell, and you saw Ingles knock down the three. He had 24 on the night, 8 out of 15 from the floor. This is a team, the Utah Jazz, that last year got everybody's attention. What's the ceiling for Utah?
You know, I picked them to finish third in the West. I think they'll keep improving. And the reason why I think they'll keep improving is because Quinn Snyder, I think he's an excellent coach. I think he's got Mitchell, you know, programmed and ready to play the right way. I like Gobert coming back as a defensive stopper. So I just like everything that Utah is doing right now.
You like Grayson Allen?
Yeah, you know what? I'm interested to see Grayson Allen and how he plays for this team because they have a lot of playmakers. Rubio makes plays for people. Mitchell makes plays. Ingles is a good playmaker, good passer. So, you know, I'm interested in watching this team blend. And I'm interested in Grayson Allen is such a good athlete, get up and down. If he runs, I got to believe with all those playmakers throwing ahead, he can get some stuff going, finishing at the basket. And, you know, he had an interesting career at Duke. And I want to see what he does in the NBA.
And meantime, on Toronto's side, Nick Nurse, you're a new head coach in the league.
Yeah.
You're doing things a little different, a little unique. Because one of the things he has, everybody has got to be in a perfect circle when he addresses the team because he wants teammates looking each other in the eye, that kind of thing. They're giving out championship belts during practice, that kind of thing. What works and how do you decide as a head coach what's going to get through to your players?
I think all those things are good. Symbolically, they're really good. The thing that I worry about is he and Kawhi Leonard's relationship because Kawhi is coming from, you know, a Hall of Fame coach and Greg Popovich, you know, arguably one of the greatest coaches ever in our league. And now he's going to be coached by Nurse. What is that relationship going to be like and what's the respect level? I know Kawhi will give him the respect, but will Nurse have the ability and will he take on the courage to really coach Kawhi and coach him hard when he needs to be coached hard?
Yeah, and I don't know, Ernie, I never was in a perfect circle once in my career. We won a lot. I don't know. I'm just not sure. I'm not sure what that means, but I say next time I coach, we're doing perfect circle. I promise you that.
We'll see how it turns out for the Raptors this year. But we come back, the highlights from Birmingham. Yes, that's where the Grizzlies and Rockets met on Tuesday night, the Iron City Showdown. Ooh. Highlights next.
Sounds.